मान्याः सदस्याः सर्वेभ्यः मदीयान् प्रणामान् निवेद्य निमेषमात्रं संस्कृते भाषणं कृत्वा यथा अनया प्रदर्शितं तदनन्तरम् अहम् आङ्ग्लभाषया व्यवहरामि। महान् सम्मोदः समजनी यत् अनया आदौ संस्कृते भाषणम् आरब्धमिति। बहवः एवं मन्यन्ते यत् एषा भाषा केवलं वैदिके कर्मणि एव प्रयुज्यते इति। परन्तु इदमस्माभिः ज्ञातव्यं यत् विज्ञानं वा भवतु, यन्त्रशास्त्रं वा भवतु, सङ्गीतशास्त्रं वा भवतु, साहित्यं वा भवतु, ज्योतिषं वा भवतु, यत्किमपि वा भवतु, तत्सर्वं संस्कृतमाध्यमेनैव आसीत् बहोः कालात् प्राक्। न केवलं तत्, सर्वेऽपि ग्रन्थाः संस्कृते एव रचिताः श्लोकमाध्यमेन च। तत्सर्वं युष्माभिः सम्प्रति दृश्यते। कथमियं भाषा अत्यन्तं गूढान् विषयान् प्रतिपादयितुं समर्था भवति इति एतैः स्पेण्टामहाभागैः उक्तं, केल्कुलस् अधिकृत्य एतैः कृतम् इत्यादिकं, तत्सर्वं श्लोकमाध्यमेनैव रचितमस्ति, अत्यन्तं रमणीयतया प्रतिपाद्यते एतैः। एतावता संस्कृते भाषणम् उपसंहृत्य अनन्तरम् आङ्ग्लभाषया वचनम्। ओ, ऐ एम् एक्स्ट्रीम्लि प्लीस्ड् टु बि हियर् सो इन् दिस् अगस्ट् आडियन्स्, and as Sudhindra ji told, it is a strange coincidence that I came in touch with this ORF, and the link was already mentioned. It was through Manjul Bhargava in some context. It was beautifully said by Spenta when he said it is a civilizational contribution. And in fact, what made me switch into the field of history of science is primarily the deep pain that I experienced that I didn't know that Indians have contributed this much. Till I did my MSc physics, I was not even aware of the name of Aryabhatta or Bhaskara, to be frank with you. And this should be the case of anybody who receives a modern training, I am sure about it. Many of us are not aware of even the names of important mathematicians and scientists who lived in this nation. And it was rightly said by Spenta when he said that it is very important for us to know that we are a part of a civilization which has also contributed immensely to science and technology. And I am sure the center will play a major role in trying to create this awareness. So this awareness, so unconsciously, will play a major role in building a self-confidence, so which is what is severely lacking. So with these few words, let me just get into the topic on which I am supposed to deliver lecture. In fact, the title, when I came here about 3 weeks or 4 weeks back, was slightly different from the title which you see in the poster. So I said, Origin and Growth of Mathematics in India. But then it turned out to be Indian Contribution to the Growth of Mathematics. I will say a few remarks towards the end, but then let us start with this, okay? So this is how I would like to go about. There are 2-3 ways in which one can approach the topic. One is trying to list out different branches of mathematics and then find out the Indian contributions. The other way is to trace it chronologically, so how it got developed in the Indian context. So it is sort of mixture which I am going to present to you today. If you see in the poster, so I thought, let me just go by the poster. The poster anyway was not designed by me. But I thought I will just go the way the poster displayed things, and it carried some sense also. So if you find in the poster, you will find prominently pi, comma 0 and then some dot dot dot. Okay. So that is why I decided that I will start with pi. So the symbol pi that you notice here came much later than the concept. In fact, many of us are not aware that pi is a very special number. So when I go to certain colleges and I ask what is pi, everyone says 22 by 7. So it is a very special number, and the first thing that I say is never say pi is equal to 22 by 7. So this is what you have to learn about pi. Conceptually, pi came into the Indian literature, mathematical literature, in the text called Shulva Sutras. So it came in a completely different context in India than what one finds in other civilizations. Indians gave a lot of importance to performing rituals. Ritual is basically trying to recognize the thing that you are blessed with. In fact, as it was said, in order to be in harmony with everything, one has to first learn to respect everything. So just now there was a discussion before the lecture commenced that we have started exploiting the nature beyond limits. I will not get into the detailed discussion of what it means, but I just wanted to tell this because there is an important verse which is found in one of the ancient texts as to why one studies this Jyotish Shastra. So as it was said by Gauri Mahulikar, that astronomy and mathematics are closely linked. In fact, the development of mathematics took place in the context of trying to solve problems in astronomy. And why did people want to solve problems in astronomy? Because you have to have your day-to-day living. So you need to know when the sun is going to rise, when the sun is going to set, how are you supposed to take your sail when you want to move from one place to other. So it needs the determination of time, the determination of where you are, in fact the latitude. So all these are very important problems for our day-to-day life. So whether it is navigation or it is civil purposes, you need to know. Or ritualistic purposes for that matter, you want to fix some muhurta, so you want to do something. So it is in this context, so people started trying to solve various problems in astronomy. Solving essentially means putting certain things in analytical fashion and then trying to predict something. In fact, a shloka goes, Vedahi yajnyartham abhipravrittaha kalanupurvya vihitascha yajnyaha tasmadidam kala vidhana shastram yo jyotisham veda saveda yajnyam. So there is a text called Vedanga Jyotisha which tries to present this. Vedahi yajnyartham abhipravrittaha. So the body of knowledge, so when we say yajna, one should not just immediately think that of offering some ghee into that, offering food into that, etc. In fact, everything is yajna. Even Yajurveda, one of the oldest body of literature which we have today, it speaks of five kind of yajnas. So Deva yajnaha, Bhuta yajnaha, Pitri yajnaha, Manushya yajnaha, Brahma yajnaha. So Manushya Yajna is, so in war of when you are received for a certain lecture, invited for a lecture, so treating them properly. So these are all Manushya Yajna. See, Swagatam, so welcoming people, so treating them with respect. So this is what is called Manushya Yajna. And Bhuta Yajna is treating every other being around you. So today it is coming up in a different way. So the core of ecology, the deep ecology, is to respect every being. The earth itself is treated as a planet. It is planet, a non-living entity, is not the way one has to think. It is a living being. As this body is a living being which undergoes a continuous transformation, so too the Mother Earth is undergoing a certain continuous transformation. So, Bhuta Yajna, so treating every other being. Pitri Yajna, respecting our ancestors. So, Deva Yajna, when you speak of, you thank the nature. So, you personify it as a divine being and then thank the nature for everything that it has blessed you. And Brahma Yajna essentially means studying. Brahma Yajna essentially means studying. So when this line says Vedahi Yajnartham Abhipravrittaha, so it is not merely sacrificing something into fire, what one has to understand through Yajna. So the entire corpus of knowledge which we call as Veda, which has been substantiated with various other literatures, etc. Yajnartham Abhipravrittaha, so in order to give you guidelines to perform yajnas, by yajna I mean all the things. So, and these yajnas have to be performed at the right time. So, when someone arrives, you have to just go and say, please come. So, you just sit for 2 minutes, don't even look at him. So, it has to be performed at the right moment. So, kalanupurvya vihitascha yajna. So, all the yajnas that you have to do should be timely. It should be done on time. So, tasmadidam kalavidhana shastram. So, you call this Jyotisha as Kala Vidhana Shastra, that which tells you appropriate times at which things have to be done. So, therefore, Yo Jyotisham Veda Saveda Yajnan. So, this speaks of the importance. Jyotisham, when I say, so it is not, see, in fact, in the broad classification of Vedangas, one does not find Ganita specially mentioned. Okay? So, when you speak of Veda, they are 4 in number. When you speak of Vedangas, they are 6 in number. So, Siksha, Vyakaranam, Kalpaha, Niruktam, Chandaha, Jyotisham. That is all. So, this Jyotisham has 2 parts, Ganita, Phalita, Hora, etc. So, Yo Jyotisham Veda Saveda Yajna. In fact, there is an interesting shloka which has one part like this. Yatkinchid vastu tat sarvam ganitena vina nahi. In fact, Sudhindraji, so when he was saying about mathematics, so this just came to my mind. So one of the mathematicians, I think it occurs in Ganita Kaumudi of Narayana Pandita, if I am right. So where does mathematics appear in our day-to-day life? So he puts this question and then he says, so everything, so in fact, so whether it is combinatorics, whether it is music, as it was referred to Manjul Bhargava, I mean, so whether it is economics, whether it is in which field can be understood without mathematics. So the mathematician having listed that it appears in this field, in this field, in this field, after 5-6 shlokas, so he finally says, Yatkinchid vastu sarvam, you name me anything in the world under the sky. Ganitena vina nahi. You can't move a bit without mathematics. Okay? So, this is what he says. So, with this introduction, let me just get into this outline. So, the history of pi. Then, the need for its accuracy in pi. Then, of course, it was said. So, it is a priceless contribution which India has given. So, the decimal place value system. The genesis of zero. Indeterminate equations of the first and the second order, the cow and the cuckoo problem. See, in fact, for the past 10 years, at least I should say, I have been roughly working in the area of mathematics and astronomy. But still, I would say my knowledge is only infinitesimal of what the Indian contribution is. I mean, what I mean to say is there are a lot of texts which needs to be studied, which have not been looked into. And today the situation is many of these manuscripts are just deteriorating. If you go to any of these manuscript library, it is not even preserved. So there is enough reason to believe that a lot of knowledge has been lost. This I can tell you for sure. Okay, so this is based on my own experience in visiting some of these manuscript library and the state in which they are maintained. One can be pretty sure that a lot of things have been lost, and it is our duty to preserve whatever is remaining. Why I said this was, this Ganita Kaumudi is an interesting text which I just came across recently. So it is Narayana Pandita, around 13th, 14th century this has been composed. One does not know the whereabouts of Narayana Pandita clearly, and it has very interesting problems. Around 1300 verses are there. It is a very, very fascinating thing. So I will just highlight a couple of problems from that. Then, so as she was saying, so from Ganita we have to transcend to Aganita. In fact, so in our Upanishad, so there is a Shanti mantra which speaks of the infinite thing. Purnamadah Purnamidam, Purnat Purnamudachyate, Purnasya Purnamadaya, Purnameva Avashishyate. This is a very abstract concept, in fact. So conceptually, if you try to think of this, it is something which is not easy to understand. So, in fact, these notions have contributed. On the other hand, if you, so this is Ishavasya Upanishad. So, if you look at this Taittiriya Upanishad, we have this Anoraniyan Mahato Mahiyan. So, this is the kind of description which one finds. So, these are the two corners. So, on the one side you find the zero, on the other side you find the infinite. See, both of them are very difficult concepts to digest. So, we feel that having zero is so easily understood, etc., etc. But in fact, there is a book which is titled Zero, then colon, the biography of a dangerous idea. It has been written by a mathematician, a reputed mathematician. I thoroughly enjoy reading a few sections of the book. So this is how he titles it as. I mean, the behavior of zero is completely different compared to other numbers. So if you multiply some number by some other number, then it will stretch the line, the magnitude should increase, or by some other number it should decrease. But if you multiply by zero, you just collapse to a point, that is all. So this is just to tell you that it has very interesting characteristics, interesting behavior. So too is infinity, and these two cannot be separated. So this is what one has to understand. And the mathematics of zero and infinity has been beautifully described by Brahmagupta and Bhaskaracharya. Okay. So, the mathematics of zero is different from the notion of zero. So, you have to put it, okay, so in mathematical form, and how it operates, the arithmetics with zero. So, I will not get into the details of all that, but I just wanted to give you a flavor of these are the different topics which are there. And to deal with some infinite thing, okay. So you have infinite quantities to be summed up, and the infinite number, each one is non-zero contribution, but it will give you some finite contribution. So if you have infinite thing to be summed up, how do you sum up infinite things? So conceptually, these are all very difficult things, and that is why it took long time. Even though brilliant minds have been there forever, so to put them in a mathematical form, it took a long time and then explain them. So sum of infinite geometric series, so how Indians handled it. Then derivation of the Madhava series for pi. In fact, I learnt it as Leibniz series, Grigori series, and that is how we find in texts. If it were to honor the one who found that, so it should be Christander's Madhava series, that people feel, because 3 centuries before Leibniz Madhava is supposed to have given this series, who is a Kerala mathematician. So then a concept of instantaneous velocity derivative and a few concluding remarks. So this is the outline. So I will quickly run through. So I want you to take note of this, the Shulvakaras, Shulva Sutrakaras, so they are somewhere around 800 BCE. So there are a class of texts called Shulva Sutras. So one of the styles of composition in Sanskrit has been the Sutra style, and that has been a very old style which is no more followed now. So if you look at 2500 years back, the style has been Sutra style. You can take Patanjali Sutra, Yoga Sutra, you can take Panini Sutra, so they are all in the form of sutras. You have Shulva Sutras, you have Brahma Sutras, you have Vedanta, Mimamsa. So any discipline, I mean, they wrote in a very terse form, which is called a Sutra style of composition. It is not poetic, but it is a very terse form of style. So there are many Shulva Sutras, so Apastamba, Bodhayana, Katyayana, so around this period, they have given the value of pi to be around this. So then when we come to this, Aryabhata, around 500, he gives the value of pi. So Chaturadhikam Shatam Ashtagunam, Dvashashtistatha Sahasranam, Ayutadvaya Vishkambhasya, Asanno Vritta Parinaha. So that is the sloka which gives the value of pi. So that is what it is. Then when you come down, so Madhava around, so this is a transition which you find. See, this value of pi is accurate to 1 decimal, 1 decimal, 2 decimal, 4 decimal and so on. No pointer there? Oh, very good. Thanks. So here, Madhava gives the value of pi correct to 11 decimal places. Okay. So how did he arrive at it? So I will just quickly say that. So the rest is not important now. So this is the shloka which I told you. Yajnartham abhipravrittaha. This is called Kala Vidhana Shastra. Okay. So Kala Vidhanam. See, in fact, if you ask this question, what is the basis on which our clocks have been designed? So is it some tick of an atom? Nothing. So it has to do with the motion of the bodies around us. So if the spin of the earth were to change a bit, think of what will happen to all these clocks. So they have to go into trash can. So this Kala Vidhana Shastram, when you say, so it is all, so the study of this has to have great impact on designing this time, etc., etc. So this for various reasons, so in fact in the Indian context, time was considered as an integral part of any event. Means if things are not performed at appropriate times, then there is a lapse in whatever you perform. So that is why they were very particular in trying to find time precisely. Okay. So with this, the explanation to Kala Vidhana Shastram, I just move on. And how does pi play a role here? In Shulva Sutras, as I told you, these are basically manuals which have been composed at a certain point of time, primarily to deal with the geometry of the altars which are involved in performing rituals. So if you were to construct a certain altar, the altar can be in the form of a round shape. The altar can be in the form of a square shape. So it can be in the form of a rectangular shape. So it can be formed on a semicircular shape. But if you just put one more constraint on this, that I want two altars, one in the form of circle, the other in the form of a square, but both should have the same area, then what do you encounter? You encounter with this number pi. So if you just impose this condition that I want two geometrical designs which should have the same area, so you have a circle, you have a square. So square, it is simple, a square, but what is the area of this? So then they had to come up with this number. They stumbled upon this and they have been improving the value continuously. Okay, this is the earliest reference where this pi comes into picture, the value of pi. Okay, it is basically the ratio of the circumference to the diameter. Okay, so that is the precise way of defining what pi is. And another thing is, so of course when you try to construct an altar, so nobody can have a precise calculation. So 2 degree, 2 decimal place, 3 decimal place, it is all fine. Why are you worried about getting in 20 decimal places? So there, the way these people tried, so in fact, why I showed this slide was to just give you an idea as to how the problems have been stated in an analytical form. So that is the purpose of introducing this slide. So how mathematics played a major role in trying to decide the accuracy with which you will be able to solve a problem in astronomy. So if the calculation is, the slide essentially shows that the sun ray comes, you put a stick like this. So this kind of a stick with a sharp tip, okay, this will be called Shankhu in Indian astronomy. So with this you can perform very interesting experiments. You can determine latitude of your place, you can determine direction, you can determine time, you can determine whatever you want, okay. So this is a very interesting thing. So you just have the sun's rays and then you draw a circle and then you measure where the shadow comes, enters the circle and then leaves the circle, etc. So based on where the shadow hits, so you will be able to find out the time, okay, at that instant. So this is the formula. It is a precise formula. I can show you. You can just take for granted. But the purpose of showing this to you was, so what is involved is cosine function and sine function and of course sine inverse function. So unless you have a way to find out these functions precisely, any of the physical quantity that you want to derive from them is not going to be accurate. So it is there the problem came. So they have been continuously trying to develop, so the techniques by which they can precisely determine the sine and cosine function. But how do you determine the sine and cosine function for any given angle? So in various traditions if you look, so most of them would have handled this problem by listing a table. That was the most easiest way to do. So this infinite series etc. comes much later. But earlier, so the method was to list for different, for fixed values of angles, you will be able to list that and then interpolation technique will be used to determine the value of sine function for an intermediate angle. In the Indian context also they had this, but then even to give the table you need to know the precise values at certain points. So there the pi plays an interesting role. So the way the Indians approach this problem is pi plays an interesting role there. So the pi, the quantity pi. So let us think of this problem. I just want to explain this. So consider a circle. We said pi is nothing but, so the ratio of the perimeter to the diameter, fine, okay. So now what is sine? The sine function which we keep telling. So geometrically you can say, suppose you mark an angle theta here. So if you draw a projection from here to this point to this perpendicular, that is sine, right? So we can say that suppose this angle is opposite side by hypotenuse, etc. is the way we normally study. But then how do you find the value of sine? So geometrically you have defined sine. So suppose I draw a line from y to this line, O W perpendicular, the ratio of this to this. So for any angle, how do I determine? So nowadays people know only this button. So I use this log tables, etc. So at different points of time, people try to do it differently. So if you see this, if you know this radius OY of this circle, so you need to know OY precisely. So you need to know this projection. If you know these two, then you will be able to get it as a ratio of that. So how does pi come into picture here? So the way the Indians proceeded was this. So they took the measure of the perimeter of the circle to be 21,600, 360 into 60, the number of minutes. Okay. So they define the circle to be having whatever be the radius of the circle, you just say it is like 360 degrees. Then, so what will be sine 90? Sine 90 is basically the radius. There comes pi. So in fact, geometrically, if you want to find out, you can easily draw certain lines and then you will be able to tabulate sines. So if you know sine 90, then you can get other values of sine. So sine 0 is 0 and sine 90 is radius, and from these two you can always geometrically construct and get it. So that is how this pi, what I wanted to say was, so they are sort of related things. Okay. So this is the kind of approach that they had. So the point is, you need to know these values precisely in order to get any of these physical quantities precisely. So the important things that they have contributed is, so they have this infinite series for sine function. So the parighi, the term means circumference, vyasa means diameter. So these two are related by this infinite series. Okay. So this is what is usually called Grigori series, and this was found by Madhava around 1350 so. Then this is one interesting thing which excited me in early 90s when I was studying this text Tantra Sangraha. So in the context of trying to find the moon's position precisely, so they had given a certain formula, and the formula which is in the form of a shloka, see, I will recite the shloka. Chandrabahu phalavarga shodhita trijyakakriti padena samhare tatra koti phallittika hatam kendra bhukti rihayaccha labhyate. So this is the shloka. So that shloka, when you put it in mathematical form, so it amounts to this. Okay. So this is what it amounts to. So that they found the precise derivative of sine inverse function, so sort of excited me. So I still do not know so how they arrived at it, but then I was quite fascinated by that. So I think so why they wanted, so if you want to do lagna, muhurta, etc., so whatever it is, sunrise, sunset time, so all are heavily dependent upon how accurately you can find sign. So this is the shloka which Aryabhata gives, but interesting part is asanno vritta parinaha. That is all I wanted to, that is where I wanted to draw your attention to. When Aryabhata specified the value of pi as ratio of two numbers, he very clearly mentions that the value which I am providing can be only taken as close by value and it is not exact. So asannaha means close by. Vritta parinaha, vritta is circle, parinaha is the perimeter of that. So the perimeter of the circle is this value, if the diameter happens to be this value, and the ratio which I am giving is asanna, only close by. There is a detailed discussion in various commentaries as to why he called it as asanna, and the commentaries very clearly point out that whatever be the unit that you choose for specifying the diameter, in the same unit you can never ever express the circumference. So there is a clear explanation of what one understands by irrationality. I would not say that it is a proof of irrationality, but it is a very clear explanation of what irrationality is. Okay. So that has been very clearly explained by later people. And in fact, the same value has been specified in Leelavati also, but as ratio of two other numbers. Okay. So you just divide by 15, you will get the same thing. Okay. And as I told you earlier, this is a verse which one finds in a text called Kriyakramakari. This Kriyakramakari has been written by Shankaravaryar. Shankaravaryar lived in 16th century. Unfortunately, we do not have So though Madhava is considered to be the pioneer of the Kerala school of mathematicians, one does not find any manuscript of Madhava which is pertaining to mathematics per se. Okay. There are two texts which have been uncovered, but those two have to do with the moon's motion. In fact, determining moon's position is a very challenging problem because it is perturbed. Moon is perturbed by various other bodies. That is why we call people who are perturbed. Okay. So here, that is why, I mean, it is a challenging problem even in modern astronomy. What I am trying to say is there will be a few dozens of perturbation terms which one has to consider into account, and it is a very interesting thing. So I will not get into that, but here actually this verse which one finds is ascribed to Madhava. So we know Madhava's work on moon's positions, because it is a very difficult thing, and we do not find any mathematic works of Madhava, but there are certain verses which are cited by later authors, and they clearly say that it is due to Madhava. Okay, so that is how we come to know of Madhava's contribution. So this verse actually gives, see, the first line of the verse gives this number, Nava Nikharva. Nikharva is 10 to the power of 11. I will talk about it later. So they have different names for different powers of 10. So Nava Nikharva is 9 into 10 to the power of 11. Vrti Vistara. Vrti is circle. Vistara is diameter. Paridhimana idam Jaguru Budhaha. Jaguru Budhaha. Budhaha, wise people say this. So this is what Madhava says. Okay, this verse which is ascribed to Madhava, Jaguru Budhaha, this verse. So one doesn't know whether this value was before Madhava, but definitely it is at the time of Madhava. Okay. So this gives this value. And Vibhudha Netra Gajahi Kutashana, there are different systems which are followed to represent numbers. One is called Bhuta Sankhya. Okay. So Bhuta is Bhuta is a being. Okay. So Bhutanam Sankhya means, see, they use certain physical objects whose numbers are evident either through mythology or through our own observation. Okay. So for instance, if one is familiar with Indian mythology, suppose I ask you, how many people with name Rama are very familiar? One, Ayodhya Rama, then? Three? she says Ramo, Ramascha, Ramascha. So three, okay, Parashurama, Ayodhya Rama and Balarama. So when they use Rama, it conveys three. Okay. So when they use Netra, okay, so it is two. Almost all beings have two. Are there beings which have more eyes? Any being having more eyes than two?
Fewer.
All mothers have one extra.
That's the secret eyes.
Yeah, there are different eyes because people perceive differently. Anyway, so this Netra refers to two. No, what I want, Anguli, suppose they say, so it is 10. So then these are the Bhuta Sankhya. Okay, that is one way of representing number. So that is what they have used here. Okay. So Veda refers to 4. Okay. So see, Bahavaha. Bahava is hand. Okay. There are two hands, and therefore that refers to number 2. So this is how this number comes. So there are different systems. I just want to tell you. Then I move on to, so the story of pi is over. Okay, I will come back to that little later. So now I move on to the decimal system. Okay, so which is again a very important contribution. So the decimal place value system heavily depends upon the powers of 10. So recognition of powers of 10. So how do we understand decimal place? Suppose I say the number 499. So we have 499. So what is the value of the 9 in the first rightmost thing? It is simply 9. So the next 9, it is not simple 9, what it is? 9 into 10 to the power of 1. The first is 9 into 10 to the power of 0. The next is 9 into 10 to the power of 1. The third is 4. So 4 into 10 to the power of 2. So each digit picks up some 10 to the power.